Good morning.
Good morning.
And a very warm welcome to our worship this morning. Welcome to any visitors joining us today. And as always, those who are watching online in our Facebook live stream, a warm welcome to you as well. We have a call to worship now on the screen. Praise be to God. That was all of us. Praise be to God, who dared to take on human flesh and dwell among us.
Praise be to God,
who did not turn back in the face of evil and death.
Praise be to God,
who continues to dance through our lives even now.
Let all that have breath sing praise to God.
Let's praise God's name as we sing hymn 110. Glory be to God. Have nature that is always there to have mercy upon us for our failings and our weaknesses. You are a God of love and forgiveness. You've shown us grace throughout our lives, forgiving and renewing us. And we pray, God, that you might keep on doing so as we turn to you now to seek forgiveness for all the ways in which we've let you down. Forgive us, God, when we have not followed in the way of Jesus as we should have. Forgive us when we've not forgiven other people when we've held a grudge. Forgive us when we have spoken to others in a way that puts them down, that belittles them. Forgive us, God, when we cause other people pain. Help us, Lord, always to seek the better way through Jesus, the way of the kingdom. For we ask this in his name, in the name of him who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. To come on down, boys and girls. How are you all today? Fine? Good, 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 good. Right, I'm going to talk about things that are true and things that are false today. And on television there's a game show called Would I Lie to You? And I've never actually watched it, must admit, but I think basically it is people making up stories and also telling two true stories, and then you've got to guess which is the made-up story and which is the true story. Okay, so what I'm going to do today, just for a bit of fun, I'm going to tell some stories about myself, about my past life, and you've got to try to guess if you think it's a true story or a made-up one, and the congregation can join in as well. Okay, so here's the first one. Okay, so if you think this is true or not, when I was 19, I went to London with a friend to Top of the Pops, which was a programme that had all the hits in the charts, and you wouldn't know anything about it because it's not been on for years, but it was very big at the time. So I went down to London with a friend, and I was staying at my cousin's house in London, and when we left his flat to go to Top of the Pops at the BBC, we shut the door and realised we'd left the keys and the tickets inside. So we broke the door down to get in, and we went to Top of the Pops and we really enjoyed it. But my cousin was not pleased with me. Now, do you think that's true? Could that really have happened? No. Does anybody think that could be true?
Yes.
No. That actually happened a long time ago when I was very silly. When I took a communion service, and we're having a communion service today after the service, in my old church in Kirkcaldy, a little mouse appeared on the communion table and started eating the bread. And I got such a shock, I knocked over the wine and it spilled all over the carpet. Do you think that's true or false? True? You think so? False. I think the consensus is false. And yes, you are right. That's a made up one. Okay. Again, when I was quite young, Christina and I, my wife and I, went to the quiz show Mastermind, which was on in Glasgow at the Borough Centre, a place called the Borough Centre. And we got lost on the way and we turned up late. And I was so disappointed not to get in that I started banging on the great big doors and shouting, "We're late, let me in, let us in." And a lady came and said, "We can hear you in the recording. Would you please be quiet and go away?" Could that be true or false? False. You think it's true? I think you're the only one that thinks it's true. But you are right, it is true. That really happened. That really did happen. Halfway through a service once in this church, I was flicking through my sermon notes and noticed that half the sermon was missing. I left the building, Donald Muir ran me down to church to get the rest of it, and I came back up, and nobody knew what was going on. That was the was young, again, it's all back to when I was young, I had a summer job at the Loch Lomond Bear Park. One day, a bear escaped into the other reserve, and I ran after it and tried to grab it and hold on to its mane, and tried to drag it back into the other reserve where it was meant to be. So I tried to grab the bear, and then it ran away. I didn't manage to hold on to it.
False.
True. That's the story that I told my children when I was young. They love that story. But that really did happen. I did used to work in a bear park, and one of the bears did escape once. But luckily we were armed with large sticks so that we could protect ourselves from it. So anyway, once I went to a concert to see a band called the Bay City Rollers. Hey. During the concert, volunteers were asked to come forward to sing the chorus of one of the band's songs. I found myself on stage singing the chorus of a song called Shang-A-Lang. Is that true? True? What do you think? Could that be true? That one did not happen. When I was young, I was visiting somebody in my last church, and they had a coal fire on, and the living room was really very cosy, and I found myself nodding off during the visit. And before long, I was sound asleep. And when I woke up with a start, the person was still talking and didn't even notice that I had been asleep. Could that be true? That really happened to me. Yes? False? No, it is false. It's probably happened to some ministers, though. In my last church again, just before the service started, there was an almighty crash at the door. And I rushed to the front door to see what had happened. And the clapper inside the bell had come loose and crashed to the ground, creating a hole in the upper floor and then the lower floor, just missing people who were arriving at church. This was the big, like a pendulum, a big stick that rang the bell. It was huge, and it just missed people who were arriving at church. And a few days later, I appeared on the front page of the Daily Star newspaper under the headline, Hell's Bells. Could that be true or false? What do you think? Could it really have happened? Have the bell coming down the room? False. True. It is true. That really happened. And I was on the front page of that newspaper. Once I was taking a service in church, when I noticed a very famous Church of Scotland minister called the Right Reverend Peter Potter was in the congregation, and I decided to welcome him to church. But unfortunately, I called him the Reverend Peter Poo Poo. Could that have happened, I think? Yes? No, fortunately not. Okay, and here's the last one. Once I was up in the attic in the manse in my house, and I suddenly fell through the attic floor, and I landed in the bedroom below. Luckily, I wasn't too badly hurt. And Mr. Mike Mackey, not here today, the famous painter and decorator, happened to be decorating the room at the time, and he actually managed to fix the very large hole before my wife Christine got home from work. Could that really happen? Yes? That is true. That really did happen. Yep. Good for Mr. Mackey. Right, so these are lots of stories, some of which were true and some of which were made up. And it is sometimes quite hard to work out if somebody is making up a story. Of course, you shouldn't really make things up unless you're telling a story that you want to entertain people with, but you shouldn't tell lies to people. But sometimes it is quite fun to make up a story. And when it comes to the stories of Jesus, people found that some people were making up stories about Jesus that weren't true. And some of them were really very silly, with Jesus doing all sorts of strange things. And people started to think, what are the true stories? What really happened? And how do we know if something is true or made up about Jesus? And the reason that we know that the wonderful stories about Jesus are true and that they really did happen is because there were people there who were called witnesses. And a witness is somebody who watches something happen and remembers it. And sometimes they may go and tell somebody else about it, or they may write it down. And that's what happened with Jesus. People called witnesses were people like his friends, Peter and John and Andrew and all the other followers of Jesus, and all the hundreds of people that saw him telling these amazing stories. And they remembered them and they wrote them down. And the stories were passed on for hundreds of years until we've got these stories today. And so we do know which are the true stories and which are the silly ones. And one of the things that is so wonderful about following Jesus is that these stories are so amazing and exciting and important for us today. And we know that they are true, and we know that Jesus is true, and Jesus is real. And that's what really matters. So when some people say it's all just made up, it's all just silly stories, they're wrong. It really did happen. And Jesus really did tell these wonderful stories. And the greatest story of all is that Jesus is alive. I'm going to say a wee prayer now. So let's close our eyes and I'll say a little prayer. Lord God, we thank you today for stories. And we thank you for people who can make up and tell wonderful stories that we read in books. But we know, God, that the stories about Jesus are not made up. They're not just fairy stories. They really happened. And we thank you, God, for these wonderful stories of Jesus helping other people, of feeding 5,000 folk, of going about making people better again, and of Jesus dying and rising from the dead. We thank you for that greatest story of all, as we ask this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing your song today, which is Give Me Oil in My Lamp.
Thank you.
sacrament of communion will be celebrated, and if you're able just to keep one of the line of chairs free and come to the front of the church, that would be great. And Church Magazine is available today. The October issue is now available for distribution by elders, and there are extra copies at the church doors. And a reminder that this coming Saturday we're having our gift day combined with Saturday coffees, and an opportunity to bring along your extra donation, if you're able to, for the ongoing work of the church. And hopefully many of you will come along and enjoy the coffees this coming Saturday. And finally, next Sunday, we are having our Harvest Thanksgiving service, and also combining it with the Boys Brigade enrolment as well. Let me turn to God's Word, and the reader this morning is Albert McClure.
Our readings today are both from the New Testament, beginning with the book of 2 Peter, reading from verses 16 to 21, and the second chapter, reading verses 1 to 3, and that can be found on page 1222. We did not follow cleverly invented stories when we told you about the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received honour and glory from God the Father when the voice came to him from the majestic glory, saying, "This is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased." We ourselves heard this voice that came from heaven when we were with him on the sacred mountain. And we have the word of the prophets made more certain, and you will do well to pay attention to it, as to a light shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Above all, you must understand that no prophecy of Scripture came about by the prophet's own interpretation, for prophecy never had its origin in the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. Chapter 2, headed False Teachers and Their Destruction. But there were also false prophets among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you. They will secretly introduce destructive heresies, even denying the sovereign Lord who bought them, bringing swift destruction on themselves. Many will follow their shameful ways and bring the way of truth into disrepute. In that greed, these teachers will exploit you with stories they have made up. Their condemnation has long been hanging over them, and their destruction has not been sleeping. Our next reading is from Matthew's Gospel, Matthew chapter 7, reading from verses 15 to 20, and that can be found on page 972. A tree and its fruit. Watch out for false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ferocious white wolves. By their fruit you will recognize them. Do people pick grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Likewise, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus, by that fruit, you will recognize them. Amen. May the Lord add his blessing to these readings from his holy word, and to his name be all praise and glory.
Sing again in 462, "The King of Love, My Shepherd Is." for example, during the period of mourning for the Queen to read about people speculating that the Queen's body was not in the coffin because of security reasons. But once people put forward such views, it's amazing how quickly they can catch on and people come to believe them. Alex Jones is an appalling individual who was put on trial in a civil case recently in the United States for peddling the lie that the terrible Sandy Hook school massacre never actually took place. The sad thing is that many people do believe the utter nonsense that he regularly spouts. Some have suggested that the 9/11 terrorist atrocity in the United States wasn't actually a terrorist act, but an inside job by the US government to create an excuse to go to war with Iraq. And there are still some people who believe that Paul McCartney died in the 1960s, and there's been somebody impersonating him ever since. Not sure how Paul McCartney feels about that. I suppose the greatest conspiracy theory of all is to believe that man did not actually land on the moon, that the whole thing was somehow staged in a Hollywood studio. And people have asked, why are there no stars in the photos? Why is the US flag fluttering? Why are there footprints, but no prints from the lunar modules, from the landers? But all of these questions can easily be answered. And yet, apparently, 5% of Americans still believe that the whole thing was a hoax. When conspiracy theories are put forward about Christianity, we do have a bit of a problem. You might remember many years ago the book The Da Vinci Code by Dan Brown came out, and then it was made into a film. And it was a huge success. Around 200 million copies apparently have been published globally. It's been translated into 57 languages. Why was it so successful, a book about religion? Partly because it's a bit of a page-turner, and you want to keep on reading it when you get to the end of every chapter. But it has to be more than that, because a lot of critics have said that actually it's not terribly well-written. It's not all that good. But what has figured in that novel and film success is the subject matter, the quest for the Holy Grail, usually taken to be the actual cup that Jesus used at the Last Supper. But the book also spouts all sorts of other nonsense about the love of Jesus for Mary Magdalene, and that Jesus had a child by her, and the descendants of Jesus and Mary Magdalene lived on under the protection of a secret society. Most reputable church historians and experts would dismiss that as complete nonsense, but people still buy in to these conspiracy stories. And I suppose one reason for this is because there are lots of things that we don't know about Jesus. And people are always happy to fill in the gaps in their own way. Or they dig up ancient documents from the first or second centuries, which at the time were deemed to be false by most people. They did not merit inclusion in our New Testament. There's a huge number of such documents out there, and there are very few that scholars would say are accurate in any sense or contain the actual words of Jesus. One of the most fascinating is the Gospel of Thomas, which some do think contains a very small number of verses that are genuine sayings of Jesus himself. Or there's the Gospel of Judas that emerged a few years ago, which seems, some people say, to cast a new light on Judas, but actually it's all really quite nonsensical, because it says that Judas was acting at Jesus' request when he hands him over to the authorities, and that Judas was Christ's favourite apostle. Rowan Williams, the former Archbishop of Canterbury, said that we are instantly fascinated by the suggestion of conspiracies and cover-ups. This has become so much the stuff of our imagination these days that it's only natural, it seems, to expect it when we turn to the ancient texts, especially biblical texts. We treat them as if they were unconvincing press releases from some official source whose intention is to conceal the real story. And that real story waits for the intrepid investigator to uncover it and share it with the waiting world. Anything that looks like the official version is automatically suspect. Someone is trying to stop you finding out what really happened. And the challenge for the church today is exactly the same one that faced the early church fathers when these false gospels and writings about Jesus were first written. What's to say that the original gospels and New Testament writings are in themselves accurate and true? Why should the Gospel of Matthew be more authentic than the Gospel of Judas or the Gospel of Thomas, written a good bit later? The church spent decades deciding what books should be going into the New Testament, what were authentic and what were false. And when we dismiss these ancient books, the Gospel of Thomas, the Gospel of Judas, so many others, we might well say, just stick to what's in the Bible. That's all that matters. Keep on believing the stories in the four Gospels. Jesus changing water into wine. Jesus walking on water. Jesus feeding 5,000 people with a boys' packed lunch. Jesus bringing people back from the dead. These are the true stories. But then you can see the problem. Some skeptical people might well say, can that really be true? Did these events really happen? What's so strange about the fact that some of these other gospels claim that Jesus was married or that Judas was his best pal? Some would say that what we would say are the authentic stories about Jesus are simply made up as well. As we heard in our readings today, there were concerns about what were called false prophets back even in the time when Jesus spoke and talked on earth. He warned his followers to be on guard against them. He said they would come looking like sheep on the outside, but on the inside they would be like wolves. Prior to the coming of Jesus, many had claimed to be the Messiah. People did so when Jesus was around. People still do so today. And in 2 Peter, we're warned about destructive, untrue doctrines appearing in the early church. Peter says that the church has not been dependent on made-up stories in making known the mighty coming of Jesus. He says, with our own eyes, we saw his greatness. In other words, Peter is telling his readers, some of whom may well have been themselves skeptical about these stories, he's saying, I was there. I saw him with my own eyes. I heard his teachings. I saw him undertake the miracles. And ultimately, Peter could say, I saw that empty tomb and the grave clothes. I met with the risen Lord. And I think this is the key point. The Gospels were written soon after the events they describe by people who either knew Jesus or new people such as St. Peter. The oral traditions began as soon as Jesus was risen. Mark wrote his gospel just around 40 years after the events that he describes. The later gospels I mentioned were written hundreds of years later. And yes, the stories of Christ's miracles, the incredible events in the Gospels, are for some people, unbelievable. But the point is that they are contained within genuine historical documents, written by witnesses, written by people who had no motivation to lie, written by those who knew Christ himself. And I think it's important for the church today to demonstrate the authenticity of these stories. That's what the early followers of Jesus had to do when ridiculous claims emerged back then, and we still have to do that today. But the stories about Jesus are not fairy stories, as many atheists tell us, not conspiracy theories, not simply the results of people's vivid imaginations. They actually happened. And even more importantly, we need to remind people about why they happened. They happened because Jesus came to demonstrate what God is like. Jesus came with a radical message that turned on its head the world's values. He came to show us how to live out our lives and how to inspire others to follow in his way. And he came to give us hope that this life is not all that there is, that when we die, we experience new life in the presence of God's love. The church is here today because 2,000 years ago, these first followers of Jesus were utterly convinced that he was the Saviour of the world, the only perfect human being who has ever lived, the one who's shown us that God is love. And so amid all the nonsense and the conspiracy theories and the distortions that take place, we must never lose sight of what lies at the very heart of the Christian gospel and never stop seeking to live out that gospel every day of our lives. Amen. We sing again the hymn, Jesus is Lord. Father God, we bring you this day our gifts of money, not as a collection, but as an offering. Not given out of duty, but given gladly. Not brought out of habit, but out of love. Bless these offerings, we pray. Living God, we've sung your praises today. But we know that there are some people who maybe find it hard to sing. We know that there are some people who are singing sad songs. We remember how your people long ago cried out by the waters of Babylon. How can we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? Because their lives had been overwhelmed by sudden catastrophe. Their hopes for the future had been crushed and their faith in your purpose had been shaken. So Lord, we pray today for those who are facing sorrow and suffering and find it hard to sing a song. We pray for those whose song is one of despair, the poor and the weak, the oppressed and the exploited, the hungry and the homeless. We pray for those whose song is one of fear, those in lands torn by war in Ukraine or in Yemen, communities racked by violence, in homes where there is abuse, people who are victims of racial discrimination or sexual harassment. Lord, we pray for all those whose song is one of fear. We pray, God, for those whose song is one of grief, those who have lost a loved one, or seen them broken by an accident or ill health, those whose relationships have ended in separation and divorce, those who've been betrayed and let down by other people. Father God, we pray for all those whose song is one of pain, for those wrestling with difficult chronic disease, for those coming to terms with a disabling injury, for those living with terminal illness. Lord God, for all those experiencing all of this, we pray that you might put a song of joy into their hearts, that you might comfort and sustain them. We pray, Heavenly Father, in thanksgiving for those who know joyful songs today. We give thanks for those who've experienced a moment of happiness in their lives. We give thanks for new parents and for the birth of a child into the world. We give thanks, God, for those who've achieved something special, for those who've achieved something they've been striving for all their lives. We give thanks simply for knowing moments of happiness and joy in the simple things in life. Lord God, we thank you for all of these things. And now, Heavenly Father, in the silence and the peace of your house, we pray for those whom we know and love, who may be in need at this time. Loving God, reach out in love and put a song of joy into all our hearts through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As well as communion, tea and coffee are served after the service. And then we close by singing hymn 449, Rejoice, the Lord is King.
Thank you.
and all those whom you love, this day and forevermore.